This is me playing the first version of Tetris ever made from 1985 in the Soviet Union.
I reverse with the hands to shoot.
Need a retry, huh?
Yeah, I need a retry.
It's like learning how to ride a bike, basically.
Although I had a lot of prior experience with Tetris, it was a struggle for me to play on it because I wasn't used to the controls. Fortunately, there was another player at the exhibit at the same time by the name of Blue Scooty. You might have seen him in the news earlier this year for being the first person to beat NES Tetris. But while Scooty did better than just about anybody else who had come up to try, the unfamiliar controls were still difficult for him to wrangle.
Let's see what your score was. 29.43 on level 9. That's level 9. Crazy. You're obviously very good.
Anybody got an extra?
So I stuck around and asked the exhibit supervisor, Stephen Wylie, if he could give me a full demonstration.
This is the Vintage Computer Festival Southwest booth at the ATG Expo in Waco, Texas. What you're looking at right here is one of our top showpieces. This is the Soviet Electronica DVK-3 computer. It's got the same CPU architecture as what Alexey Pajitnov wrote Tetris on. He used the Electronica 60, which is basically the pizza box server version of this desktop computer. So we can actually run the original Tetris binary and play the game just like he had written it back in the 80s. The screen that we're on now is the intro screen that you see when you're first running the game. You can select a level from 0 through 9, 7 for left, spacebar to drop, 8 to rotate, 9 will go to the right, and you can just kind of go to town with the game. Anyway, we'll just spam the buttons now and we'll kind of finish it up. So there we go, there's a high score chance. I can type in a name. It writes in Cyrillic, and then we can hit enter, and then there's how I fared compared to anybody else who's been playing.
But surprisingly, the most interesting aspect of this exhibit was how difficult it had been to even get it to run at all.
This computer was built by the Soviet Union back in 1989, but it's actually a clone of an American machine that came out back in 1970. Digital Equipment Corporation made the PDP-11 all the way back then, and 20-ish years later, Soviets are still copying it. I imported this from a fellow from Moscow. This thing came to me right from Moscow back in 2017. Getting this to work was a bit of an endeavor for me because, A, I don't really speak Russian. I didn't really read Russian at the time. And so one of the things I had to pick up on was, how do I take the Cyrillic letters and transliterate them into English? And so once I learned kind of the translation between Cyrillic and English alphabet, I could at least start writing stuff down into Google Translate, and then it would give me the translation. And so I went through pages and pages of the documentation that I had as hard copies of that actually came from the seller. The system first booted up into something like this, where it just has the @ and a memory address. And what you're in now is something called the Oct debugging terminal. It's basically waiting for you to give it machine language instructions to tell it what to do next. And so what you can do from here is you can write an address into a piece of ROM. This is the Cyrillic keyboard, and so the layout is completely different than, you know, anything that I'm used to. So I kind of have to hunt and peck for everything on here, which is super weird. And it will actually load up the operating system. This is the RT-11 operating system, something that Deck wrote way, way back in the day. You can see there's kind of the Russian twist on it, so to speak. Okay, there we go. There's the system specs for the thing. It tells you the boards that are installed. The MX board is disk drive controller on here. I'm not actually using these disks. This is an SM5508 hard drive. It's a 10 megabyte drive based on the ST412 that Seagate released back in the, like, 1982 or so. The people from Eastern Europe tell me this is a piece of garbage hard drive, basically. I should just throw it in the trash right now and not even bother saving it. The two floppy disks, I need to probably clean them and make sure they're in good shape before really working them. So what I actually have is an HXC floppy disk emulator that I've stuffed way back in this case behind this hard drive. And that's what's emulating the floppy disks that I have, you know, a real bulletproof method of running code up on here. And so here's all the stuff that I have. So to run the game, I can just type in run. And then since it's on MX1, I can put Tetris, and now I gotta wait for this to go and then spam the 7, and luckily that worked. Anyway, you get the idea. But yeah, there's kind of a summary of running a PDP-11. I went through this thing and I had to replace a bunch of old Soviet capacitors in here that were probably out of spec and, you know, making the thing not work incredibly reliably. When I first got it, it really only worked about 1 out of every 4 times I would turn it on. But recapping it, now it works about maybe 9 out of every 10 times. So much better reliability now that I've replaced the capacitors. You know, basic maintenance on these things and such you can learn from the experts at BCF Southwest to come and visit the show.
Wait, so what was that at the end?
The bigger thing is the Vintage Computer Festival Southwest. About 10,000 square feet of this stuff. We have PCs, Amigas, Ataris, ZX Spectrum, Commodore, VIC-20s, you name it, the whole works. And even people bring server machines and workstations and old-time vector graphics machines from the 70s and space shuttle stuff and large punch card machines and you name it. So a ton of things to see in retrospective. And so definitely please join us at BCF Southwest.
So yeah, if that sounds like your kind of thing, definitely check out their website, which I'll have linked in the description to find out more info about their future events. And thanks again to Stephen Wylie for the interview. And thank you to all the Patreon supporters for this channel, with a special thanks to Scott Gray, Gilbert Tang, and K9 Watching Tetris. K9 is actually co-hosting his first live Tetris event next month along with Martz in Montreal, Canada. And they've got some incredible plans and an all-star guest list so far. So if you're within travel distance of Montreal, y'all, be sure to check out the links in the description if you're interested in attending. See you guys in the next video.